So our lens flare is starting to come together really nicely. We can see that we've got really good counter motion with our different elements, and we've got different attributes that fade in and out based on distance. Now, there's two things that I want to address inside the material, just as kind of polished pieces. One is that we want to have this so that as the center or any element of the lens flare gets towards the edge of the screen, we want this to fade out. So if we keep our eye here on the source or the core of our lens flare, as it gets towards the fringe of the screen, this really hasn't dimmed at all, right? We can do this on any side. Its intensity stays the same. Another thing that we see that's really broken is that if we go underneath the ground and the lens flare is being occluded by the actual object itself, a lot of our elements are just rendering straight through, which is definitely not what we want. This isn't sorting properly, and this would be a serious issue if we had this, like, let's say on a pillar or something like that, where the character could walk around 360 degrees. So let's start off with the first problem of getting this to fade out on the side. So inside the content browser and the materials, remember we said that all of these elements up here on the top, the reflection elements, are instances of our parent material. So if we open up the start version of it, any changes that we do are going to be propagated down. So our material is pretty simple right now. It's just our texture sample being multiplied by a vertex color. What we want to do is search for something called a radial distance expression. So if we search for lens flare, we can see all the different lens flare expressions that we have here. And right in the middle, we have radial distance. So let's go ahead and dump one of those in there. And what this is going to do is it's going to measure the lens flare's system in camera or position in camera space, and then it's going to dim it based on that. So let's go ahead and multiply these down and let's see what it does. So let's take our texture and multiply it by the lens flare radial distance. And then that output result is going to go against our vertex color. Now we see it disappear, and that's okay. If we close down or move down our content browser material editor, it's kind of working, but it's actually working backwards. We can see as the particle system is straight in the center of screen position, it's disappearing, and as it gets towards the fringes, it's getting brighter. So to fix that, let's go into the material editor, and all we want to do is we just want to invert our radial distance data. So let's search for a 1 minus. And then take that 1 minus, or I'm sorry, our lens flare radial distance, and plug that into 1 minus, and that result is going to be multiplied against our flare texture. Let's compile it. And now we can see it's doing what we want. As it gets towards the edge, it dims out. Now, in my opinion, first of all, we can see that it's doing some funny things, like right there, it's starting to go into negative numbers. We don't like that. The other thing is that I do want it to fade, but I don't want it to completely disappear. I think that's kind of weird. So what we can do is inside the material is clamp it to fix both of those issues. So let's make a little room and let's search for a constant clamp. And let's take that inverted, that 1 minus result, plug that into our constant clamp, and now take the constant clamp and multiply that against our flare texture. So inside of the constant clamp, we have a min and max value. What I want to do is just say, hey, I don't want you to ever go below 0.3. So let's clamp that to 0.3. And now let's compile that. And now as it gets towards the edges, it's definitely dimming out, right? But we can see now that it's not getting completely black. And it's also not doing those negative number kind of funkiness that we saw before. So that looks pretty good. I like that. But if we go underneath there, we can still see that we have our other issue and the occlusion isn't working. So let's go back to the material. I'm going to pan out a little bit. And what we're looking for, if we search for lens flares again in the material expression, we're looking for this lens flare occlusion expression. Let's dump that in and let's multiply this out. And now you don't necessarily have to do this at the end like I am. We can do it before or after, but I'm just going to leave this at the very last thing so that lens flare occlusion is really the last thing to determine whether this thing's rendering or not. So let's multiply this now, our lens flare occlusion, against all of our texture sample stuff and the radial distance stuff that we've just done here. And let's compile that. You'll notice that the lens flare has disappeared, and that's okay. And the reason that's happening is because the bounds of the lens flare haven't been calculated yet. Basically they have, but they're really large. So if we go into the lens flare and open up the start version, what we need to do is right click over here in the black area next to all of our different elements and do select lens flare. And on the properties here, we're going to have all the kind of master properties of the entire lens flare system. So in bounds, we can see that the used fixed relative bounding box option isn't checked. And what that's going to allow us to do is enter our own numbers in. So if you use this button up here on the top that says toggle bounds, and you rotate around, you can see this blue box and this yellow sphere is pretty ginormous, right? So it's using that to calculate that expression that we used to base when to fade it off. And because it's so large, it's just fading it off immediately. So let's go ahead and check this, right? We can see now that it's at zero, so we don't even see it rendering anymore, but our lens flare has come back, which is good. Let's do for min, let's keep this small. Let's do negative 10 on XYZ. And for max, let's just also set that to 10. Oops, change that to 10. We can now see our bounding box here in world coordinates. I can turn the grid on to give that a little more relevance and perspective, but we can see that it's pretty small. So if we move all this down now, we can see that our lens flare is rendering, and that if we go underneath here, it actually starts to fade. Now, what it's doing, just so we understand the math, is it's using those bounds to compare it to surrounding geometry, and it uses that to determine the intersect that's happening here, and it's just using this curve that we're going to learn in a second to fade it in and out. So it's working almost. I want to tweak one more thing. One thing you might notice is that the lens flare is looking very, very dim. Now, one way to fix this is if we move this up, if we go out of game mode and select the lens flare, it should brighten up a little bit, as we see there. But I want this to be hugged, right up against it. So what we can do is inside of the lens flare system itself, going back to the master property, so we right-click and do select lens flare, we have this bottom option here called occlusion, and it gives us this screen percentage map. Now, there's no way I've been able to determine to show this curve over here on the right, so we're just going to have to look at the numbers. But it's giving us a constant curve with 2 points, at 0 and at 1, and it's using this value to basically, this is what's determining the fade that's happening. So if I change this second value to 0.4, we can see not only is it brighter, let me go ahead and deselect this, but this also determines how quickly to fade this in and out. So if we change it to 0.2, that fade transition would happen even faster. So there's no one right solution. It's all really based on how big are your lens flares, how many objects do you have in your scene, how big are your objects. But those are the two sections that you want to adjust to kind of massage things to get them working right. So that's about it for this chapter and for this tutorial. So I think we've covered a pretty good grounds on how to create a particle system to get you started. I'm going to end kind of in a weird way, and I'm going to end with a warning. Don't go crazy with lens flares. It's actually really easy to go overboard with these, and it's going to look really obnoxious aesthetically, and it's also going to kind of upset your players because it can become really cumbersome to have so many of these over on the screen. You just want to be very tasteful with these. My teacher put it best in college. He said, you know, cinematographers for decades have been trying to work ways to eliminate lens flares, and then suddenly in the past 10 or so years, you know, people are just loving lens flares and using them left and right for style. So just kind of, you know, take it easy with them. I think this is a great way to add some style and flair to your level, but don't go overboard with them. So I hope this has been informative, and thanks again for joining me on here. And please keep in touch with us here on imbueFX, because we've got lots of great new tutorials that are planned up for the future. And thank you for your time.